Good morning. Well, I hope you all came excited to worship the Lord today. And we are thankful that you gathered here. And we're going to sing about our God's mighty power. I sing the mighty power of God. Let's all stand together. We'll sing two verses. Let's stand together as we sing. I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command and all of the stars obey. There's not a plant or flower below but makes his glories known, and clouds arise and tempt his foe by order from thy throne. While all that borrows light from thee is ever in thy care, and everywhere that man can be, thou God art present there. Amen. Wonderful singing. You may be seated. The mighty power of God. Think about it. He spoke the world into existence, and he's everywhere. He's the omnipresent, all-powerful. And as my friend Charles Hugbrook say, he's omni-agapable. He's all-loving. Amen. I want to let you know about several things. This morning after the morning service, we have a brief meeting about the Nicaragua missions trip. Coming up end of July and beginning of August. And so if we can meet in the choir practice room, and I just want to get some information into your hands about that trip. And y'all be praying for us as we prepare to go. Looking forward to working with Tyler Carlton in Pueblo Nueve. It's about 3 hours north of Nicaragua, Managua, the capital city there in Nicaragua. And then we have trustees meeting at 4:30 tonight, evening service, continuing our series on spiritual gifts in these sign gifts tonight. After the service tonight, we will have a meeting for all those who would like to help with the outreach during Bike Week here in Leesburg. Morris United Methodist Church has graciously given us a section of their property to pass out tracts, evangelize, give out Bibles, pray with folks. And last year we did this, and we had several professions of faith. And so if you are interested in just signing up for a block, I know it's over 2 days that you can't be there the whole time, but there's a lot of folks who could be there for a couple hours. And so we need at least two people each in overtime frames to man the tent. And just to pray with folks, encourage folks, share the gospel, pass out tracts. And so if you're interested in that outreach, and that's the end of this month, 26th and 27th, meet in the choir practice room after service tonight. And then again, we have a lot happening this week. On Tuesday is Joy with Mark Lanier. Mark is going to be a first-timer for us, a wonderful singer. You're going to be blessed by his talents, but also that you're going to be blessed by the food. Jen's making homemade lasagna for Tuesday, so we're going out with a bang. You need to sign up so we know how much to prepare for. And I know some of you have already said you want some to go. So if you do, you really need to put down in advance, I would like two lasagnas to go wherever, so we know how much to prepare. We normally sell our leftover meals, but the last couple of times we haven't had a whole lot of extra to spare. So we're going to have a great time on Tuesday. Bring somebody with you. I love Joy Days. And also Joy's taking a trip to Wikiwachi to see the mermaids, and that is on the 23rd. You can sign up for that as well. That's out in the lobby. And several other things happening this week. Wednesday night, prayer Bible study, youth group, and all those things. But that's why I give you a bulletin. Read those. And then out there, again, we are doing a silent auction for a hand-painted illusion of a pineapple. that was donated to help raise funds for our youth ministry. And that is an original, only one like it. That's an original hand-done print. If you look at it, the doilies look like they could be real from a photograph, and really appreciate that donation. The way that works, if you want to increase the bid, you just write your name and then how much you want to increase the bid by. So thank you for supporting our youth ministry pastor.
Well, good morning, church. It's good to see you today. A lot of folks that need our prayers. Jim Jewell's sister has just been put in hospice, and I think Jim went up there to Ohio to be with his sister. Also, David Paga. David is in Leesburg Hospital on the cardiac floor, most likely facing bypass surgery tomorrow. They did a cardiac catheterization on Friday and apparently found some blockages, so he's... I'm going to go up and see him right after church. Remember him, Cheryl Bass and Sharon Capone and a number of others on our prayer list and our missionaries of the week. So let's unite our hearts together in prayer today. Father in heaven, thank you for giving us this day of life and the health and strength you've given us to be here today. We thank you for those watching via the live stream. And so we pray today, God, you know our needs, you know our hearts. You know more about us than we know about ourselves. You know everyone that is here. And God, I pray that you would do a work in every heart and life today. Help us to go away somehow different than when we came in. If there's someone today who's come to church who's never come to know Christ, may today be that day when the Spirit of God draws them with cords of love to the Savior. And we are so thankful today for our missionaries of the week, for Josh and Alex Zuniga, this precious husband and wife who work with Freeway Ministries in Orlando, reaching homeless, reaching street people, reaching people that mostly would never walk through the doors of a church, but are being reached where they are and brought into the family of God. Thank you so much for their ministry. And we pray that it would continue to grow and you would provide the funding necessary for all of their outreaches. And thank you for Thelma Narvaez. She has labored now in the Philippines for many years, just turned 89, and still serving you at the Pateros Independent Bible Baptist Church in Manila. Thank you for those who recently have been saved and baptized in that church. We thank you, God, for the ministry and that was started by she and her late husband, Pedro, and now under the direction of a new pastor and a Filipino man. We thank you, God, for what you're doing there. And we do pray for Jim Jewell's sister, for David Paga, for all of these on our prayer list. God, so many. Sharon Capone, just out of the hospital. A number of others. Alan Taylor, so many. Names that come to mind. And God, we prayed for them during our Bible fellowship hour, but we lift them again to you today. We pray for the music and the message, and God, today that you would help us just to put out of our minds all of the other activities and distractions that beckon for our attention, and help us to focus for this next hour on you, the God of this universe, and what you would have for each of us today. And may the Lord Jesus Christ be lifted up, and may men be drawn to him, and may all the praise and honor go to our precious Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture this morning is taken from Isaiah chapter 40, and we're going to begin in verse number 12. And if you're able, stand with me out of respect for God's word this morning. Such a great passage of scripture. And then the choir's going to sing about this in just a minute. Behold our God. Verse 12 says, who hath measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and meted out heaven with the span and comprehended the dust of the earth in a measure and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who hath directed the spirit of the Lord? Or being his counselor hath taught him. With whom took he counsel? And who instructed him and taught him in the path of judgment, and taught him knowledge and showed to him the way of understanding? Behold, the nations are as a drop of a bucket, and are counted as the small dust of the balance. Behold, he taketh up the isles as a very little thing, and Lebanon is not sufficient to burn, nor the beasts thereof sufficient for a burnt offering. All nations before him are as nothing, and they are counted to him less than nothing and vanity. To whom then will ye liken God? Or what likeness will ye compare unto him? The workman melteth the graven image, and the goldsmith spreadeth it over with gold and casteth silver chains. He that is so impoverished that he hath no oblation chooseth a tree that will not rot. He seeketh unto him a cunning workman to prepare a graven image that shall not be moved. Have ye not known? Have ye not heard? Hath it not been told you from the beginning? Have ye not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in, that bringeth the princes to nothing. He maketh the judges of the earth as vanity. Yea, they shall not be planted. Yea, they shall not be sown. Yea, their stock shall not take root in the earth. And he shall also blow upon them, and they shall wither, and the whirlwind shall take them away as stubble. To whom then will you liken me? Or shall I be equal, saith the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high, and behold, who hath created these things, that bringeth out their host by number? He calleth them all by names, by the greatness of his might, for that he is strong in power, not one faileth. Thank you. You may be seated. Listen to Behold Our God.
Who has held the oceans in his hands? Who has numbered every grain of sand?
Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice.
Come let us adore.
What a great God we have. Behold our God. We're so thankful if you're a guest today that you've chosen to worship with us. We know there's a lot of options for you in the local area, and we're so thankful you came to be with us today. If this is your first time in front of you in the seat back, there's a card that looks like this. We call it a connection card. We would love it if you would take a moment and fill that out and give us as much information on the card as you feel comfortable sharing. I can guarantee you that we will never misuse your information. We'll not show up at your house uninvited. We'll not share this information with anybody. But we would like to connect with you in the best way, whether it's by email or text or phone or send you a letter. But we are so thankful that you're here today. And if at the end of the service, if you'll come out to the foyer, there's a desk in the foyer we call the Connection Center. If you'll come by there, we will put a gift in your hands as a thank you for coming today. We appreciate you being here. And now we're going to worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. And wow, I'm so thankful for what you're doing for missions. We have, this past couple weeks, we have blown it out of the water. Man, our budget to this point in the year, since the first year, is $47,600. And our faith promise mentions is $52,074. So we are about $5,000 above budget. And we're using some of that money, extra money, to help missionaries with special projects. We support them every month. We need $3,400 a week just to make our budget for support for these 128 missionaries on the walls. But every once in a while, they need something special. We just send out $4,000 in special projects. So our deacons are the ones who help with that, and they're the missions committee, and we appreciate what they're doing. And so thank you for what you're doing for God's work here at Grace and also around the world. And we ask the ushers to come and wait upon us and as we give our tithes and offerings. And again, if you're a guest today, we don't expect you to support the ministry of this church. Our members do a wonderful job of doing that. We're so thankful that you came today. Don't feel obligated to participate, and unless God leads you to do that, certainly we would never forbid you doing it if God leads it, but we don't expect it, and we just are thankful that you're here today. Brother Ellis, would you come word our prayer for us as we give thanks to God?
Thank you. I was glad when someone said, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." Amen. It's good to see everyone here today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, our Father, merciful and so kind. We're ever so grateful for all that you've done for us. You've kept us safe and you've provided for us. We're grateful for each individual that's here today and each family that's represented. We collect this offering, Lord, for your holy purposes. And lead and guide us in its uses. And may you bless the gift and the giver. And may we do everything today according to your will. And these favors we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. We are standing in his presence on holy ground. Let's stand together as we worship the Lord in song. We bow down. You are Lord of creation, Lord of my life. We bow down and we worship you, Lord.
You are Lord of creation and Lord of my life, Lord of the land and the sea. You were Lord of the heavens before there was time, and Lord of all lords you will be. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down. We worship you, Lord, Lord of all lords you will be. You are King of creation and King of my life, King of the land and the sea. You were King of the heavens before there was time, and King of all kings you will be. We bow down and we crown you the King. Bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. King of all kings you will be.
Isaiah chapter number 6, it says, when the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. His train filled the temple, and above it the seraphims, and with two wings they covered their faces, and with their feet, and with two they did fly. And verse number 3 says, and one cried unto another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory. Amen. Let's sing, holy, holy, holy.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which word and art and evermore shall be. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy work shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
You know, salvation required a perfect sacrifice, a holy sacrifice, Jesus Christ, separate from sin, but not from sinners. Aren't you thankful he came and he died in your place? The spotless Lamb of God, only a holy God. Amen.
Who else commands all the host of heaven? Who else can make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun? What other majesty? majesty rules with justice. Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Consumes like fire. What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Forever a holy God, come and worship the holy God. Who else could rescue me from my failings? Who else would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God, only my holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God.
Let's sing together this song. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. You know, it's a holy place. It's filled with God's people, holy people. That's what God wants you to be. Be holy, for I am holy. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Let's sing this together.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Amen. Thank you for your worship. You may be seated. Just before the message, we have a special song by Colleen.
Discouraged, why should the shadows come?
Colleen. Jesus said in Matthew 6, "Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they?" We'll take your Bibles to Matthew 7, and inside your bulletin you have an outline that we call Grace Notes. Take it out and follow along in the message this morning, dealing with dogs and hogs. Matthew 7, 6 is our text, but for context, I would like us to go back and begin at verse number 1. "Judge not that ye be not judged. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, Let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye. Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye." We talked about that last week, and verse 6 says, "Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you." Now, the words we're studying today have a strange ring to them. The Lord Jesus Christ, who commanded us to take the gospel to every creature, warns us not to cast our pearls before swine. And he who warned us against judging others is now the very one calling people dogs and pigs. The tone of this verse seems to grate against what we read in the previous verses. John R.W. Stott explains this shift in tone with these words, quote, "The context provides a healthy balance. If we are not to judge others, finding fault with them in a censorious, condemning, or hypocritical way, we are not to ignore their faults either and pretend that everybody is the same. Both extremes are to be avoided. The saints are not judges, But saints are not simpletons either. End of quotes. That's an excellent point. Only simpletons, to use his word, would throw a piece of steak to a stray dog or a string of pearls to hogs. Dr. John MacArthur writes, quote, this principle is why Jesus himself did not do miracles for unbelievers, Matthew 13:58. This is to be done in respect for what is holy, not merely out of contempt for the dogs and swine, end of quotes. That's a great perspective. He says, that which is holy, it would be unthinkable to offer consecrated meat from the sacrificial altar to a pack of wild dogs. Equally unthinkable would be to cast a string of pearls into a pen full of pigs, because neither dogs nor hogs could appreciate the precious and priceless nature of what was set before them. Most likely, this illustration is a reference to preaching the gospel to those who might be either unappreciative of the priceless gift or angered by it. And to do so would be to violate the principle that is found in these verses. Again, I think John Stott adds some clarity with these words. He says, quote, if people have had plenty of opportunity to hear the truth, but do not respond to it, if they stubbornly turn their backs on Christ, if, in other words, they cast themselves in the role of dogs and pigs, we are not to go on and on with them, for then we cheapen God's gospel by letting them trample it underfoot, end of quotes. Now, you know, what's amazing to me, Jesus never said anything accidentally or incidentally. So let's look deeper into what this verse says and what it means to us and how we can apply it today. So let's talk first about the dogs. And I will spare you the comment about who let the dogs out. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs. Now, when Jesus talked about dogs here, he is not referring to the cute little pet dogs of the home in Matthew 15:26, when he said it is not fitting to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. In response to that statement, you remember the Canaanite woman said, truth, Lord, but the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. So, but Jesus is not referring to Lassie. He's not talking about pets. This is a reference to the dogs that are wild, mangy pariah dogs that roam in packs and prowl for garbage and dead carcasses, whose bark was annoying and whose bite was infectious and even lethal. And hogs, of course, were considered the most vile, unclean animals imaginable. So Jesus isn't talking about Lassie, and he's not talking about Miss Piggy. He was talking about people who act like vicious animals. King David described some of his enemies as acting like mean dogs. In Psalm 59, verses 12 through 15, David said of his enemies, for the sin of their mouth and the words of their lips, let them even be taken in their pride, and for cursing and lying which they speak, consume them in wrath and consume them that they may not be. And let them know that God ruleth in Jacob unto the ends of the earth, Selah. And at evening let them return, and let them make a noise like a dog, and go round about the city. Let them wander up and down for meat, and grudge if they be not satisfied. Doesn't that sound like some people today who prowl around late at night looking for trouble? He talks about these dogs going around at night looking for something to eat. I have a dear friend in law enforcement who I've been in his office several times, and he has a sign behind his desk, and it says, nothing good happens after midnight. And there's a lot of truth to that, isn't there? The prophet Isaiah referred to the false prophets of his day as dogs. In Isaiah 56:10, his watchmen are blind, they are all ignorant, they are all dumb dogs. They cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Yea, they are greedy dogs, which can never have enough. And they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, everyone for his gain from his quarter. So, dogs always has a very negative connotation to it in Scripture. Paul warned the believers in Philippi about the legalists who were demanding that every man among them be circumcised in order to be saved. And he said in Philippians 3 and verse number 2, beware of dogs. He wasn't talking about the four-legged kind. He was talking about the two-legged kind. Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the concision, which is kind of a play on words. It means the flesh cutters. On the last page of your Bible, the Apostle John described the heavenly city. And then he went on to talk about who would not be there. In Revelation 22:15, for without or outside are dogs and sorcerers. By the way, interesting word there, sorcerers. It's not what you may think it is. It's the Greek word pharmakia, which means drug abusers or drug users. Whoremongers, murderers, and idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. So dogs always has a negative connotation. Please notice again the context here of Matthew 7, 6. It follows verses 1 through 5, which talks about judging in the sense of condemning, censoring, criticizing. There are two extremes that must be avoided when applying these verses. At the one end of the judgment spectrum is a harsh, hypocritical, condemning spirit. And that is something we are not to do. But the other dangerous extreme on the judgment spectrum is an attitude of total permissiveness. No judgment whatsoever. You know, the model of total permissiveness is live and let live. You ever heard that phrase? Well, just live and let live. Today, this attitude is often concealed within the politically correct cloak of tolerance. Tolerance. Tolerance has become the catchword today for anything goes. Tolerance means you can't disagree with me because if you do, you're intolerant. And the only people we do not tolerate are those like you Christians who are intolerant. Talk about a double standard. Some of those who preach tolerance are the most intolerant people on the face of the earth. So if harsh condemnation is at one end of the judging spectrum and total permissiveness is at the other end, what are we to do? Well, the Bible says we're to make evaluations about people. We're to use discernment and make wise judgments. As Jesus said in Matthew 7, verses 15 through 20, by their fruit ye shall know them. You can't judge a tree by its leaves, but you can judge a tree by its fruit. You can't judge a book by its cover, but you can judge a book by its contents. By the way, why does a dog or a hog act the way they do? It's because they're nature, right? You can take a hog from the pig pen, you can give that hog a bath, you can shine up its hooves, you can put a pretty red rib around its neck and put some perfume on it, but the first chance that pig gets when you open the door, it's going to go right back to the pig pen, right? Because it has a pig's nature. See, you can wash it on the outside, but it doesn't change the nature on the inside. And it reminds me of what Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse number 22. When he said, but it has happened to them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to its own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. See, the reason that the dog goes back to its vomit and the pig goes back to the slop is because that's their nature. But isn't it great that even though we all have a filthy nature, when Jesus Christ comes into our lives, he makes us a partaker of the divine nature? Amen. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. When Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, he identified, again, some people who will not be in heaven. And he said in verse 9 of chapter 6, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And then he said in verse 11, and this is the key verse, and such were some of you. But ye are sanctified, but ye are justified, but you're washed, you're sanctified, you're justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. You see, aren't you glad that what we once were, we're not now, right? We're new creatures in Christ. It doesn't mean we're perfect or sinless. We're not. Paul could say in Philippians 3, I count not myself to have apprehended. I haven't arrived spiritually, but I keep pressing toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. But I'm not what I want to be. I'm not what I ought to be. I'm not what I one day shall be by God's grace. But thank God I'm not what I once was, right? I've been changed. I've been washed. I've been sanctified. I've been made new in Christ Jesus. Thank God for the new birth, John chapter 3, which gives us a new nature. And the important question today is, have you been born again? You know, do you know that? Jesus said in John chapter 3 to a very religious man, you must be born again. You know, religion will never get you to heaven. In fact, religion can be one of the greatest hindrances to a person being saved. You don't need religion, you need a relationship. So the dogs, these are people who in Scripture are a picture of unsaved outside the realm of Jesus Christ. The dogs. Don't cast what is holy to the dogs. But then notice what else he said here in the rest of this verse. He said, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you or tear you or tear you up. I don't know how many of you ever had go on a wild boar hunt, but they have those tusks and they can tear you up. They can tear up hunting dogs. They're vicious. The hogs, mistaking the pearls for peas, might become angry and attack those who cast them. So what's Jesus saying? He's saying use discernment so as not to waste your spiritual treasures on those who are hostile to the truth. This idea is also found in Proverbs 23:9, which says, speak not in the ears of a fool, for he will despise the wisdom of thy words. You know, Jesus practiced what he preached. He applied this principle to the 12 when they went out on their first preaching mission. In Matthew 10:14, Jesus said, and whosoever shall not receive you nor hear your words when you depart out of that house or city, shake off the dust off your feet. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Jesus said, if they don't receive your message, just dust the dust off your feet. Jesus refused to do mighty miracles in Nazareth because of their unbelief. According to Matthew 13:58, the Bible says that he could do no mighty miracles there because of their unbelief. He followed his own advice about not casting pearl before swine. You know, the Jews told Jesus that that Herod was out to get him. And this was the Herod Antipas. And here was Jesus' response to their statement, Herod will kill thee. He said in verse 32 of Luke 13, he said unto them, go ye and tell that fox, behold, I cast out devils and I do cures today and tomorrow and the third day I shall be perfected. Now, Jesus didn't call Herod a dog or a hog, but he did call him a fox. After Jesus was arrested and put on trial when Pilate found out he was a Galilean, he sent him to Herod and he tried to pass the buck. So, hey, go see Herod. And so when he went to Herod, the Bible says in Luke 23:8, when Herod saw Jesus, he was exceeding glad, for he was desirous to see him of a long season, because he had heard many things of him, and he hoped to have seen some miracle done by him. Then he, that is Herod, questioned with him, that is Jesus, in many words, but he answered him nothing. Jesus had no words for Herod. You know, the Apostle Paul refused to argue with people who resisted the word. In the book of Acts chapter 13, in verses 44 through 48, and the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy and spake against those things which were spoken by Paul, contradicting and blaspheming. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, but seeing ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. Said, basically, we're done with you. In Acts chapter 18, verses 5 and 6, and when Silas and Timothy were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit and testified to the Jews that Jesus was Christ. But when they opposed them and blasphemed, he shook his raiment and said, your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean. From henceforth I will go unto the Gentiles. So here in a nutshell, it's the principle of verse number 6. Don't give what is holy to the dogs. Don't cast your pearls before swine. Discernment must temper our declaration of the gospel. While it is true that Jesus told us to carry the gospel to every creature, Mark 16:15, it is also true that we must not cheapen the gospel by a ministry that lacks discernment. The glorious treasure of the gospel has been committed to our trust. Yes, we are to share it with everyone, but there are some people that are so resistant and hostile to the truth that it's like giving that which is holy to dogs or casting pearls to swine. Jesus said we can expect two reactions from spiritual dogs and hogs. The first one is they will trample them under their feet. Trample them under their feet. In most cultures, stomping on something is a sign of disrespect, an insult, even hatred. We don't want anyone stomping on our flag or on our Bibles. I think it's interesting, recently in another state, someone burned a trailer full of Bibles in front of a church. Hardly anything was said about it. If it had been a trailer full of the Quran, there would have been all kinds of uprising about hate. But Christians are easy targets. Let me tell you, in case you haven't noticed, there's a growing movement to silence or stamp out the Christian message here in America. Amen. But these that Jesus called dogs and hogs only reject the message, they will attack the messenger. Notice what he said, they will turn again and rend you or tear you. Not just verbally, but sometimes physically. You know, there was a time earlier in our country when all the church had to do was ring its bell and members of the community would gather. Today, you're more likely to have someone call the police and complain about the noise. So here's the big question. How are we to respond to those who reject our Jesus? Are we to give up on them? Well, no, never give up on them. But if they've become hostile to your sharing Jesus with you, and I know some of you have family members that won't even hardly speak to you because of your love for Jesus. So you don't give up on them. But here's what you do. You live the Christian life in front of them, and you pray for them. You see, it's no coincidence that verse 6 comes before verses 7 through 11. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. Prayer is the greatest weapon we have. And let me tell you something. They may resist your logic and they may resist your testimony, but they cannot resist the power of prayer. Pray that God will open their eyes to the truth. Pray that God will put someone in their path who might have a better understanding of how to present Jesus to them. Don't cross them off your list. It may be just a matter of timing. Some of the greatest testimonies have come from people who rejected the gospel for years, and then they heard the message and were gloriously saved. So don't ever give up on them. Live the Christian life in front of them. Pray for them. Spiritual dogs and hogs. Now let me close with one last category of people, and that's the open. The open. You see, there are people who don't want to hear our message. And there are some who not only reject the message, but will reject the messenger. But instead of dogs and hogs, we need to target people who are open to the truth. I love that story in Acts chapter 16 where Paul went to Philippi. The Bible says in verse 13, on the Sabbath we went out of the city by a riverside where prayer was wont to be made, and we sat down and spake unto the women which resorted thither. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshiped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. And when she was baptized and her household, she besought us, saying, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us. This very successful merchant woman, a purple dye, was very exquisite and very valuable. This merchant woman got saved and then invited Paul and his cohorts into the house, where they used this as a base of operations to start the church at Philippi. Then the demon-possessed girl got saved, the jailer got saved, and his family, and the church started forming. But instead of wasting the truth on those who don't appreciate it, find those who are ripe and ready to hear the good news. Let me tell you something. Jesus is the pearl of great price, right? Matthew chapter 13, verses 45 through 48. He's the message we preach, just like in Acts 35. I love when Philip was called to go from Samaria down to the desert toward Gaza. And by the way, we need to keep our Israeli friends in our prayers, especially now with the attack of drones and missiles going into, well, most of them were intercepted before they hit the ground. But we need to pray for what apparently is a big escalation of the war in the Middle East. But when Philip went down to Gaza, the Bible says he joined himself to the chariot that the Ethiopian eunuch was riding in, and he saw that he was reading Isaiah 53, and he said, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And he said, "How can I, except some man should guide me?" And the Bible says in Acts 8:35 that Philip began at the same place and opened the scriptures and preached unto him Jesus. He preached Jesus. You see, that's the message, Jesus. So, Pastor, who are those who are open? Who are those that we need to be preaching the message of Jesus to? Well, first of all, let's start with children. Let's start with the children. There's no such thing as a mean piglet. Remember Babe? So let's devote our attention to sharing Jesus with as many children as possible. I'll tell you something, the enemy is also after our children. Drag queens trying to teach them in libraries and all kinds of craziness going on. Satan is after the minds of our kids. Here's what Jesus said in Mark 10 and verse 13, and they brought little young children, and actually the word brephos means infants. They brought young children to him that he should touch them, and the disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, "Suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein." And he took them up in his arms, put his hands upon them, and blessed them. Kids, let's reach kids. That's why we have kids' classes. That's why we have Kids Club on Sunday. That's why we have Route 252 and We Kids. That's why we have Awana. That's why we do VBS. Why? We want to reach kids. Let's reach our children. Another group we should target is teenagers. I praise God for the ministry of Pastor Seth and Jen and all of our youth ministry workers. They're seeing young people come to Christ. And who can forget on Valentine's night, February 14th, when 11 teenage girls got baptized in our baptistry. By the way, surveys have found that if someone is not saved before age 18, only 1 in 40 are saved after that time. Only 1 in 40. How many of you that were in here were saved before age 18? Raise your hands. Look at that. All over the auditorium, the majority of people in this room. I got saved when I was 20, but again, studies show that only 1 out of 40 people who are saved, get saved after the age of 18. Let's reach our teenagers. I had a chance several years ago when our daughter, who's now in glory, when she graduated high school at Leesburg High School, they asked me to do baccalaureate. I don't even think they do baccalaureate anymore. Did they do that still? That's good to hear. But I chose a passage of scripture for baccalaureate from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 11, verse 9. "Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth, and walk in the ways of thine heart in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou that for all these things God will bring thee into judgment. Therefore remove sorrow from thy heart, and put away evil from thy flesh, for childhood and youth are vanity." Chapter 12, verse 1, "Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them." And there's three R's, you know, and we all reading, writing, and arithmetic, you know, the three R's of education, but there's three R's in here: rejoice, remove, and remember. And that was my message. Rejoice, God wants you to be happy. Remove, God wants you to be healthy. And remember, God wants you to be holy. Let's start with children. Let's reach teenagers. And another group we should focus on is people around the world who have never heard the message of Jesus Christ. You know, I'm not saying we should give up on America, but America is full of pagans, even though there's a church on almost every corner and a Bible in almost every hotel room. And I think that the gospel is like water off a duck's back to many people living in our country. But there are millions, untold millions of people in this world who have never, one time,
heard. The name of Jesus.
Oswald Smith is credited with saying, why should anyone hear the gospel twice before everyone has heard it once? Not only kids, not only teenagers, but the untold millions around this world who have yet to hear. That's why our church is so heavily involved in missions. That's why last year our church gave almost $250,000 to missions. We want people to hear. People, I love that verse in Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a great verse. I'm a whosoever. I don't know about you, but I'm a whosoever. You can put your name in it. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But then he goes on to say, how then shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I am so thankful for the work of the Gideons and others who get the word of God out, Wycliffe and so many others. They're trying to reach this world with the word of God, because people need to hear the message. They need to hear in order to be saved. Living a good life is important, but no one gets saved just by looking at a good life. They have to hear the word of God. They have to hear the message. You know, one day Jesus sat on a well and told a woman with a very sordid past about the living water. And she was so transformed by this truth that she went into the town, she left her water pot, and she said, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? And they came to Jesus, and as they were coming, and Jesus said to his disciples in John 4:35, say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest? Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white, all ready to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. Lift up your eyes and look on the fields. They're white to harvest. The open. There are people right now waiting for somebody to bring them the gospel message. And Psalm 126:5-6 says, they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. And the Bible tells us in Galatians 6:9, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. So what do we learn about dealing with dogs and hogs? Well, don't waste your time arguing with those who are antagonistic toward the truth, but look toward those who are open and receptive to the gospel. I so appreciate my library. God has given me an extensive library. In fact, I can't even hold it all in my office. I guess you could say I'm a book hoarder. Confess guilty to that. But I've got all of Spurgeon's sermons from the time he started to the time he died. And I've got a number of his books, lectures to my students, a number of great books by Spurgeon. And let me just close with his quote on verse number 6. He says, when men are evidently unable to perceive the purity of a great truth, do not set it before them. They are like mere dogs. And if you set holy things before them, they will be provoked to turn again and rend you. Holy things are not for the profane. Without are dogs. They must not be allowed to enter the holy place. When you are in the midst of the vicious who are like swine, do not bring forth the precious mysteries of the faith, for they will despise them and trample them under their feet in the mire. You are not needlessly to provoke attack upon yourself or upon the higher truths of the gospel. You are not to judge, but you are not to be and not to act without judgment. Count not men to be dogs or swine, but when they avow themselves to be such, or by their conduct act as if they were such, do not put occasions in their way for displaying their evil character. Saints are not to be simpletons. They are not to be judges, but also they are not to be fools. And then he closed with this. Great King, how much wisdom thy precepts require. I need thee not only to open my mouth, but also at times to keep it shut. How true. We need to know when to speak and when not to speak. And that's the theme of verse number 6, dealing with dogs and hogs. Today, if you don't know Jesus, I hope you won't reject him. Because there will come a time when God will give you up. The old timers used to call it crossing God's deadline. When God says, okay, I'm done. You'll never hear from me again. It's like it says in Proverbs chapter 1, because I called and you refused, your sorrow is going to come upon you like a whirlwind. God says there's going to come a time. You know, God is immensely so patient, is he not? So long-suffering. But there comes a time when it says, he that being often reproved hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. I think that's in Proverbs 29. There comes a time when God says, I'm going to turn you over to your own reprobate mind. And I think we're seeing a lot of that in our country. I think in many ways, perhaps, I hate to think it, but I think in many ways our country may have crossed God's deadline. As Billy Graham once said before he died, America is not too big to shake its fist in the face of God and get away with it. We need to be very careful. Because God is love and God is holy, but also God is just. And he is righteous. And he will not allow us to get away with sin. Aren't you glad Jesus came and took upon himself the sin of the world, died upon the cross of Calvary as the perfect substitute for you and I, and shed his blood to wash our sins away if we'll come to him in repentance and faith. Just like that dying thief on the cross next to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. It is finished. The price is paid. There's nothing you and I can add to that. You know, there's no good work we can do to get into heaven. That good work has already been done by Jesus. We simply have to receive him as our Savior. If you've never done that, come today. If today, you know, you feel like you're born again and you're scripturally baptized and you feel that God is leading you to this church and you want to come and be a part of this church, we open the doors today for membership. Say, come on in. We'd love to have you. Let's link arm in arm and help reach this place for Jesus Christ. Let's reach these kids. Let's reach these teenagers. Let's reach the world with the gospel of Christ. If today you need prayer, come to this altar. As Jesus said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. If you need someone to pray with you, we'll have someone pray with you. In just a moment, we're going to have an invitation, and that's just what it says. It's an opportunity for you to respond to the message today and to do what God may be beckoning in your heart to do. July 23rd, 1972, I sat in a service just like this, heard Dr. Mark Blackwell preach. And that day, God got a hold of my heart. Said, are you going to come? I said, yes, sir, I'm coming today. And I came and said, Lord, do for me that what I cannot do for myself. And I tell you, there weren't any great demonstrations that day, but I can tell you that a deep, settled peace came over my soul. And I walked out of that church saying, hallelujah, 'tis done. I believe on the Son. I'm saved by the blood of the crucified one. Amen. If you don't know Jesus today, come. If you need a church home, come. If you need prayer, come. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time this morning. I pray that you would use this invitation to fulfill your will and purpose. And may Christ receive all the praise. In his name I pray. Amen. As we stand and sing an invitation hymn, would you come today if God has spoken to your heart?
Behind me, the
cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back.
One more verse of that, and we can just sing the very first verse. I have decided to follow Jesus. And you know, if you need to be saved today, today's the day of salvation. You know, I don't know your heart. God can see into your heart. But if He were to ask you this morning that question, if you died today, are you 100% sure you'd see me in heaven? Are you 100% sure go to heaven? You know that if you were to die, you were passing this life. You'd ask you, why should I let you into heaven? What would you say? Those are all important questions. And the answer is this: have you been saved? Have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? Have you been saved by the blood of the crucified one? You need to be saved today. The altars are open. I know that we have many people who love to take you through the scriptures and how you can know that for sure. If you have another need, you just want to pray. You just say, you know what? I just need to be more evangelist. I need to open my mouth more. Actually, I've kept it shut too long. I need to open it up more. Whatever it is, you come as we sing one more verse.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
Sing again. Others are coming. You come as we sing.
The world behind me, the cross before me. Behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning.
And they ask the instruments to play through one more verse. And if you'll just be there in an attitude of prayer, perhaps the Lord is speaking to you about being involved in something in the ministry here. Perhaps after that message, you say, no, I need to come tonight to that meeting about our Bike Week outreach and need to go out there and just be willing to talk to others. Just be sensitive to the Lord and then do what He asks you to do. That's what you need to do. Do what the Lord asks you to do.
Well, thank you. You may be seated for just a moment. And I want to ask the following people to come up. And we had a Discovering Church membership luncheon last week. And these are some who did take that luncheon. And so Ludi, come on up here. This is Ludi Harbaugh, and Ludi is coming upon her statement of faith, knows the Lord Jesus Christ, been scripturally baptized. Also, Steve McWilliams. Steve, same. And then Bob and Kathleen Snyder. Bob and Kathleen, come on up here. All of these are coming upon their statement of faith, that they know Jesus Christ, have been scripturally baptized. We've already talked about our doctrine and our agreement with our doctrine, and say, I want to be a part of us. So, want to be a part of Grace Bible Baptist Church. If you're happy to have them, signify by good hearty amen. Amen. Any opposed? And there's none. Oh, we're so thankful. Bob and Kathleen, bless you all. And Ludi and Steve, God bless you. Get around to shake hands with them and give them the right hand of fellowship. Welcome them into our church family. Amen? Amen. Y'all may be seated. All right. Well, praise God. Thank you so much. And we have we'll have another class coming up if you're interested in learning more about our vision and our values and what we're all about. They've all
signed a membership covenant, and they're like, we're on board. Praise God. We're so thankful God brought them our way. All right. So if you're a guest today, stop at the Welcome Center. See me. I have a gift to put in your hands. Tonight, Pastor Seth will be speaking on the continuing his message on spiritual gifts. And so hope that you'll be back for that. And right after the service, Nicaragua missions trip meeting. Then tonight, after the evening service, pardon me, we'll have a meeting regarding Bike Fest. And so, Pastor Seth, come close us out.
Amen. Let's all sing together as we're dismissed with a song, He is Able, More Than Able, to accomplish what concerns me today.
He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today.
Get around our new members here. Greet them. Tell them you're glad to have a part of the fellowship. You are dismissed.